off today, look at the last half of this chapter. And if you were here last week, you remember I said that since I'm going to take a little break during the month of August, when we come back, we're going to start a new series, a different book. And so I'm going to trust you to study chapter 13. And when I asked if you would, I heard a few weak amens scattered around the congregation. So I'm trusting you to take a look at chapter 13 on your own and let the Lord speak to you. And then when we come back after homecoming, we will begin a new chapter, a new book. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 is where we are. We're going to begin at verse 11, that portion that was read from verse 11 through the end of the chapter. And I believe that the Apostle Paul has an important message that I want to emphasize as he relates his situation and the story of his ministry there in to the Corinthians. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for communicating to us through your word. We thank you that we can read it and understand it. Lord, we pray that it would be more than just head knowledge today, but that it would penetrate our hearts, change our commitment to you and to others. And we'll give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the biggest battles that we face in our Christian lives is to stay focused on the needs of others. It just seems as though it's a difficult thing for us to take the focus off of ourselves and put it on God and others. And yet that's what we're commanded to do. There were two friends that went to a restaurant to eat, and they both ordered the same fish. And so the waiter came and brought the fish on one platter, and one was a bigger piece of fish than the other. And he put the platter down on the table. So one of the guys went and he took the big piece of fish and put it in his plate and took the smaller fish and put it in his friend's plate. Well, the friend was very upset at this and saying, why would you do that? And so his question to him was, well, what would you do? And so a friend said, very sanctimoniously, he said, no, I would have taken the smaller piece of fish and given you the bigger piece of fish. So the first friend said, well, I got it. So thank you. You know, it's difficult for us to put the needs of others ahead of ourselves. It's one of the struggles that we have. It's a constant place of wrestling in our lives from day to day to be able to focus on the needs of others. And I think as we look at the last half of this chapter and we look at Paul's argument here with the Corinthian church, that one of the things that we can learn from this is that Paul had learned how to focus on the needs of others. Now, if you remember in the early sections of this book and throughout the book, that Paul was constantly defending himself against those false teachers that were there in Corinth. He was defending his ministry. He was defending his apostleship against these false teachers who wanted to sideline him and who wanted to relegate Paul to some smaller position in the church where they would be able to have influence. And the first thing that Paul comes out with in the middle of all of this defense in the earlier chapters and even into this chapter is that in verse 11, he says, I have become a fool in boasting. That the process of him bragging about his ministry and bragging about his relationship with God and defending his apostleship, he says, in the process, I've become a fool. It's foolish to focus on yourself. After teaching in the earlier section of this chapter that we should be satisfied with God's grace in the good times as well as the bad times. Anybody remember that from last week? After teaching that God's grace is always sufficient for us, Paul points out that it's foolish then for us to focus on ourselves. And throughout this book, we've seen that Paul felt compelled to defend himself against the charges of these false teachers that had wormed their way into the church. In spite of the pressure that Paul felt, in spite of the pressure from these false teachers and all that was going on in the church, he realized that when all is said and done, it's foolish to worry about what people think about you. Somebody needs to say amen. Because Paul understood that any defense of his apostleship needed to be focused on the needs of the church, not on his own needs. I had a conversation not that long ago with another pastor who was going through a difficult time in his church, and the exhortation that I was giving him is that whatever response we have, it needs to be with concern for the church more than concern for ourselves. And I think it's applicable to all of us, because we all run into situations where, you know, you hear that somebody's talking about you. You hear that somebody has something bad to say. There's some gossip going around. We find ourselves in a situation where we feel as though we need to defend ourselves. But any defense that we come up with needs to be focused on the needs of others. It can't be a response just to defend ourselves if it's going to result in hurting somebody else. Are you with me? He goes on to remind us here that I do not seek yours, but you. For the children ought not to lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. And just like a parent, sometimes you have to defend yourself against the kids. Hopefully not too often, but we need to always, as parents are concerned about the children more so than children are concerned about the parents, in our daily relationships we need to have the same kind of love and concern, that even when we have to discipline and even when we have to defend and even when we have to answer back, it always needs to be in a loving way. It always needs to be with the needs of others in mind. Because guess what? God is for you. And if God is for you, who can be against you? We need to trust God because he has our back. We need to learn to trust him. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. He will repay. And what Paul realized is that anything that does not contribute to loving God and loving others is foolish. And it takes away from who we're called to be. And so, you know, you hear the old expression that, you know, I went into a situation and lost my religion. Well, you shouldn't lose your religion. Because there are situations that will cause you to lose your religion if the focus ends up on you and not on others. And so when the heat is turned up and the oven of the circumstances gets hot and you find yourself in a situation, we need to remind ourselves that it's foolish to focus on ourselves. We need to focus on others. I believe that's a word for somebody here today. Paul's life had already been his best defense. Paul's life and love was focused on others. Starting at verse 12, we find here that Paul not only saw that it was foolish for him to brag and boast and get pulled into some of the discussion that he was having, but he also realized that, you know what? I don't really have to say a lot because my life speaks for itself. They wanted to pull down his apostleship. They wanted to not recognize who he was as an apostle. But he's saying, my life speaks for itself. He demonstrated, and I think this is an interesting verse. Actually, I'd like to do a little more study on this myself. But he says that he demonstrated all the signs of an apostle, including signs, wonders, and mighty deeds. Now, in order to get the context here, you remember these guys were trying to say, Paul's not really an apostle. that he doesn't have this position in the church where we have to listen to everything that he has to say. He's no better than anybody else. And Paul is defending his apostleship, his position in the church, and his apostleship, he's saying, is defended by the fact that there were signs and wonders and miracles that accompanied the apostles. Now, that means that, not everybody out there calling themselves an apostle is an apostle. I hope you understand that. A lot of people print business cards and pass them out. There were 12 apostles that actually, the capital A, that actually walked and talked with Jesus, that saw him in the flesh. Those were the apostles. And what Paul is alluding to is that one of the signs of being one of those 12 apostles was that there was accompanying their ministry signs and wonders and miracles. Now, that's not to say that there aren't signs and wonders and miracles today. I believe that God still can perform miracles. God can still step out of the bounds of nature. God still heals people. God still does the miraculous things that have no explanation today. But the difference is, and I want you to get this, the difference is that when Peter walked out of the temple and he said, "Silver and gold I don't have, but what I have I give to you," they didn't stop to have a prayer meeting to beseech God. He just told the man, "Get up and walk." When the apostles, they had an authority in their apostleship that allowed them to speak and it happened. And I believe that is a different level of authority than we have as believers today. God can still perform miracles, but we got to have a prayer meeting about it and speak to the Lord. And at the end of the day, we're not sure what God's going to do. We leave it in God's hands. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so I can't command God and tell God what to do. I pray to God and I seek his will and I leave it to his best wisdom as to how he's going to do. There's sometimes when God speaks to us in faith and we stand on the promises of God, and by faith we can have confidence that God is going to move and God is going to act. But that is still even different than saying, "You get up, take your bed and walk." That was something that was exclusive to those apostles. And Paul is saying here that part of the defense of my apostleship, I'm just not another church member. I'm not a back row sitting Christian. I'm an apostle. And part of my defense of my apostleship is that there were these signs, wonders, and miracles that accompanied my ministry. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so Paul defends his ministry in that way. His life was his best defense. His ministry itself was his best defense. And although it's all about the grace of God, he was nothing by himself. He just recognized that God had worked through him in this special way to make him an apostle. It's sort of like being a branch on the vine. You know, we've talked a lot about being a branch on the vine. The branch can't brag about what it can do. The branch is simply there recognizing that but for the vine, but for the grace of God, I wouldn't be able to do anything. And so Paul's defense was not lifting himself up, but in essence, it was lifting up Jesus. It was lifting up the vine that he was attached to. And so he could say it's foolish for the branch to focus on itself. Paul's life and love was focused on others. Here's another way that we find in the text that his life was focused on others, because his whole life was an example that we can follow. He went out of his way to visit and to build up these saints. I'm going to ask if they could put that map up on the screen, because Paul, it says that he was ready to make his third visit. Is that what the text says? His third visit to Corinth. And I need you to understand that when we talk about, you know, here he is in Ephesus over there, and here is Corinth over here. And so this was not a half hour trip around the corner, you know, a drive down to Norristown to visit somebody. This was a long journey by ship. And it was days to take that journey from Ephesus over to Corinth. And Paul says, this is the third time I've done it. Now Corinth was not the only church that he was starting. You know, in the missionary journeys, he had churches all over. And we don't know how many times he visited each one of them. But what that tells me is that Paul was constantly on the road as much as he could. He was pushing and striving to visit, to meet the needs of others. His whole life and ministry was focused on others. If Paul had decided, you know what? I'm just going to kick back and take my life is going to be easy. This is already his second missionary journey. After the first missionary journey, he could have said, you know, got a few churches going. It was a great run. You know, get me a hammock in Antioch and swing. But that's not what he did. His whole life and ministry was focused on others. And that's a challenge for us. I wonder how many of us could say, like Paul, you know, my life is focused on meeting the needs of others. I'm willing to go out of my way. I'm willing to inconvenience myself. I'm willing to sacrifice in order to meet the needs of others. I'm challenged by that. It's a little thing that you could jump over in the text when he says that this is my third time. I'm saying third time. This is not around the corner. This is a major sacrifice on his part to go and visit that church and to meet their needs. And so not only do we find him sacrificing time, but in this world in which we live, that promotes a self-sacrifice, I mean a self-focus, it is actually countercultural for us to focus on the needs of others.
We spend so much every day. Time, money, we use up, we waste so much. We spend time and money every day until it's all gone. Precious resources, powerful resources. What if you reinvested your time into prayer, your resources into support to help us plant churches, prepare leaders, and proclaim the gospel? What if you became a prayer fellowship partner? GOGF has been planting churches, preparing leaders, and proclaiming the gospel throughout the world since 1961. 14 churches on the Eastern Seaboard, producing weekly radio broadcasts that reach around the globe. We have ministry training in India, Africa, and the Caribbean. Partner with us. Partner with God. Invest in expanding and supporting His kingdom worldwide. Become a prayer fellowship partner. You have the time and resources. Make a difference.
Countercultural. And you and I today need to be countercultural. You see, the world that we live in actually promotes a self-focus. All the expressions that you hear, grab all the gusto. You only go around once. Look out for numero uno. All those expressions that we have, the world is telling us constantly that we need to focus on ourselves. You can't meet anybody else's needs until you have all your needs met. And that's the message that the world is telling us. And so that's what sin is all about. Sin, I've said it a million times, sin is all about selfishness. Sin is all about that self-focus. And the world is actually promoting in us as Christians a selfish heart when we listen to all those messages and we walk out the door with this idea that I've got to take care of me. I've got to look out for me. And it's true that we do need to take care of ourselves. There's nothing wrong with self-love, but there is something wrong with selfish love. Are you hearing me? That we need to keep the love of ourselves in proper perspective and in line. The commandment, the great commandment, is that we need to love God and love others and love others the way we love ourselves. That implies that I do love myself, but it also implies that I keep the love for myself in its proper place so that it doesn't supersede my love for others and my love for God. Is somebody hearing what I'm saying? But the world is promoting a different message. The world's promotion is all about loving yourself. It's all about grabbing what you can grab. It's all about doing what you can do for yourself. You know, can you imagine promoting Ebola or AIDS? And, you know, I was when I was in Africa, I found out that there are some tribes that actually they're not promoting AIDS in that sense, but what they're doing is promulgating AIDS because they have this belief that the cure for AIDS is to have sex with a virgin. So these infected men go around and get these virgin girls to have sex with, thinking that it's a cure for their AIDS, and they're just spreading it around. And so, you know, we think that's terrible. Can you imagine spreading AIDS or spreading Ebola or spreading some of these terrible diseases around? But let me tell you something. The disease of sin is being spread around, and some of it is being promoted right in the church. And we need to be aware that that Paul, he had his focus on others more than on himself. And so Paul says that he would gladly spend and be spent for the welfare of their souls in verse 15. I like that. To spend refers to what he has, his money, his possessions, the shirt off his back. He would give whatever he had to help somebody else. But to be spent refers to everything that he is and all that he can do. And so, in other words, Paul was focused on others, and it meant more than just what you see. It meant more than just what you pray about. It meant more than watching those TV shots of poor children. It meant more than hearing a missions moment and saying, I'm going to pray for them. Paul's life and love was focused on others. And we can do a better job of focusing away from ourselves and focusing on the needs of others. And you know, if we're honest with ourselves, let's take a second and be honest with ourselves. All of us are infected with this selfish virus that just tends to turn all the focus on ourselves. You know, our own happiness, our own satisfaction, our own needs being met, and we neglect the needs of others. Paul's life and love was focused on others, and we need to follow that example as well. Amen. And then I want you to see in verse 18. He says in verse 18 that he urged Titus and sent his brother with him, our brother. There was another brother there that he sent along with Titus. And then he asked some questions. Did Titus take advantage of you? Did he not walk in the same spirit? Did we not walk in the same steps? And so what Paul is saying is not only was he personally willing to spend and be spent to meet the needs of the church, but that he also encouraged Titus and this other brother for them to go and do the same thing. Now, all I'm simply saying is that we need to not only focus on the needs of others ourselves, but we need to encourage others to also focus on the needs of others. We need to be encouraging others to love God and love their neighbor. We need to be encouraging other people around us. If we're going to be countercultural, we need to encourage people around us to be countercultural and not always think of themselves first. Now, you know, I'm talking to some parents, and I've always said, you know, one of the biggest obstacles that we have is Christian parents for when it comes to serving God and people giving their lives to God. You know, there are a lot of mission organizations that recognize that, and I've said this before, that the biggest obstacle to Christian young people giving their life to missions and going out to serve the Lord are the Christian parents. You know, you pay all that college money and you want to go where and do what? Are you kidding me? And it's Christian parents that many times squash what God is trying to do in the lives of young people. And so we need to be challenged that not only should we be willing to spend and be spent in our lives, but we need to be encouraging that in the people around us. It certainly starts in our families, but it goes beyond our families to people that we have influence with, whether in the church or other people that are in our circle of influence. We need to be encouraging people that you know what? God can take care of you. You can trust him. He's not going to leave you out in some tribe somewhere barefoot and nothing to eat. That God can watch over you. If you give your life to God, he has a wonderful plan for your life. And it might not be that you have $1 million in your pocket. It might not be that you're driving the big Escalade. But God has a wonderful plan for you if you commit your life to him. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That's not the message that our young people are getting. That's not the message that the world is shouting at us. That's not the message they're going to hear in school. That's not the message that they're going to hear on TV. And if we don't communicate that message to people around us, they'll never hear it. They'll never hear it. We need to focus on the needs of others, ourselves, be willing to spend and be spent, and we need to encourage people around us to be countercultural, to be radical in their thinking as they give their lives to God. Amen. I'll say amen myself. And so we need to do everything we can to fight this society that's shouting in our ears. And you know what? If we all focus on others, then together we can do more. We can meet more needs. We can bear more burdens. We can encourage more saints. We can see more people come to Christ. We can do more ministry if we all work together, if all of us are willing to spend and be spent the way Paul was. There's a Jamaican expression. I don't know if I got it right because I should have passed this one by Carol to find out. But I think it says something like 1-1 coconut full basket. And that just simply means that, you know, you put a coconut in, somebody else puts a coconut in. 1-1 cocoa, full basket. Yeah. If you put your nickel in the jar, I put my nickel in the jar, and pretty soon we can get something done. And that's the way it is, that if all of us together sacrifice and all of us together are willing to spend and be spent, then together we can do a lot. Your nickel and my nickel, pretty soon we have a dollar and we can actually get some ministry done. We see it work in the church as each of us are encouraged to do our part and to do what God has given us to do. We're able to meet the needs of others. You know, even here at Monco, we see it worked out where we're able to give thousands of dollars each year to support missionaries around the world. And we're able to give thousands more to meet needs of both saints in the church and those in the community that need food or help. And the obstacle for us being able to do even more is this selfish love that we have, where we are focused on ourselves. We need to fight that. And so the Bible charges us in the great commandment to love God and to love our neighbor, as countercultural as that is. We're commanded to love God above all and to love others as we love ourselves. And so we need to encourage that in ourselves and then encourage each other to keep our hearts in line and focused on others. Then lastly, the last thing I want to show you is in verse 20. In verse 20, he says, "For I fear lest when I come, I shall not find you such as I wish, and that I shall be found by you such as you do not wish, lest there be contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, backbitings, whisperings, conceits, tumults." You know, when everyone stays focused on others, it eliminates contentions, jealousies, outbursts, selfish ambitions, backbiting, whisperings, conceits, tumults. And Paul didn't want to go back to Corinth after that long boat ride and find the church in an uproar with all the contentions and fighting that go on. Now, we got a few parents here in the house, and if you've raised children, then you know that, you know, especially when they're young teenagers, and you decide you're going to leave them alone for a while in the house and go somewhere, and you would like to come back home and have a nice warm greeting, you know, a nice time of, you know, how was it, and have a nice greeting there with the family. But you know, like Paul, that, you know, when you walk in the door, you're afraid that what you're going to find is contentions, outbursts, fightings, all that. You can go right down the list. Every parent probably can identify with that. And yet Paul's desire was to have a nice greeting time with the church. He wanted to find everything in order. The dishes are done. The chores are done. Everything's taken care of. The house is all neat and in order. But like every parent can tell you, sometimes when you open that door and you step in, it's a whole different ball game. And so that was Paul's concern. And Paul is saying that it is that getting rid of that selfish love, getting rid of that me first mentality, being able to focus on the needs of others and putting the needs of others ahead of ourselves, that's going to eliminate all the fighting, all the fussing, all the contentions, all the outbursts, because it'll, you know, we'll all be like little Burger Kings. Have it your way. You know, I don't need to fight about this. Have it your way. And so wouldn't that be a prescription for a wonderful church? You know, everybody is, have it your way. You know, no, it doesn't have to, we don't have to fight about that. We don't have to have that contention. We don't have to have that outburst. It would be a wonderful, wonderful place if we all put the needs of others ahead of ourselves. And that's what Paul's challenge is. I believe his life is a challenge to us. And so the lesson for us today is to walk away with this clear and simple exhortation to fight the temptation of selfish love and stay focused on the needs of others. I'm going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes. And I know the temptation is to say, "Oh, that was a nice message, good word," and start thinking about other people that needed to hear it. But I believe this word is for each and every one of us. It's a battle that we all fight every day of our lives. That selfish streak rises up in us so often. And I wonder if we can just take a moment in prayer and just ask God to help us with that. Help us to be more like Paul, to be willing to spend and be spent for his glory, for his kingdom, for the welfare of others. Could you do that? And maybe the Lord is bringing some specific issue to mind, and you would like prayer today and regarding some particular area where you need to commit your heart to God. Now, I just want to pray with you. An upraised hand, say, Pastor Tony, just pray for me. Is there one like that? Just slip a hand up. Amen. Yes, I see those hands. Yes, I see those hands. Amen. Yes, I see that hand. Any others? Last call. Just slip a hand up, and I'll include you in prayer. Yes, amen. See those hands. Yeah. Then, Monco, let's stand for that word of prayer. Let's pray together. And Lord, again, we commit the issues of this challenge to you. And we pray that by the Holy Spirit that you would burn it deep into our hearts. Help us not easily dismiss the challenge that the life of the Apostle Paul leaves with each and every one of us. A life of sacrifice, a life of giving, a life of service, a life willing to spend and be spent for the kingdom of God. Lord, help us as we continue this battle with the flesh to fight this desire to meet our own needs first. Lord, we pray that you would speak to each one of us. We pray especially for those that raise their hands. You know exactly what they stand in need of, what that particular issue is that they are praying about even now. Lord, we lift up each one of them to you in prayer. And may all of us leave here today with a renewed commitment to walk with you and to live in a way that's pleasing to you. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name.